Barry Bloss, retired detective with the York City Police Department.
And how long were you with the York City Police Department?
26 years.
26 years. And when you retired, what was your final position?
I left in 91, but then I became the York County coroner for 16 years and finally retired about 6 years ago.
Okay. And so, take me through some of the cases in that that you worked as you were a homicide detective at one point, right? And discuss like Tina Knobbs' disappearance and her when she was found like under the College Avenue Bridge. Can you take me through that day and
see what happened? She first was reported missing almost 15 months prior to finding her body. The guy she was living with and had a child to didn't report her missing immediately. And Tina's mother came to see him because she hadn't heard from her daughter. And the daughter had just had a child, I'm going to say 6 or 8 weeks before this, to the guy she was living with. So she hasn't heard from her, so she came to see the boyfriend and said, you know, what's up with Tina? He said, well, I don't know, she left. He said, did you report her to the police? He said, no. She then says, well, we're going to right now. So she gets him in the car and they go in and report Tina missing about 3 days after supposedly that she disappeared. Now, of course, this is information according to the boyfriend. So we didn't get too involved in the case really until, I knew her personally. I was in the juvenile division for a while and she used to run away a lot. And so I knew her parents and we'd, as juvenile detective division, we'd go out and get word and we'd find her and return her to her parents again. So it wasn't uncommon that she would run away. Although I hadn't known much about that after she had her children, you know. But anyhow, we did, you know, I knew a lot of her friends, and if I'd see them on the street, I'd say, hey, did you hear anything from Tina at all, you know? And everyone's, no, you know. And, you know, we'd check back with her, the boyfriend that she was living with, and he said, no, I haven't heard anything from her. Now, the odd thing was, if she left, and this is a story he gave us, that she left and said she was going out to visit a friend. This is the same family that we used to go and find her at their house. At that time, they used to live up on South Street when she used to run away a lot. Since that, they had moved on Newbury Street just off of Philadelphia, about the third house in. And Tina at the time was living on West Market Street in an apartment about the third floor there at the, it used to be the old Pontiac dealership. She was living in there with this boyfriend. And he claimed that she left and went up there. He didn't want her to go, and he took some steps to try and stop her. But finally he just said, well, just go. That's his story. So in asking about her over a period of every time I see a lot of her friends, we never found her. And then one morning or one day, some kids from York High used to go down underneath the Prince Street Bridge, usually smoke cigarettes, something like that. And so some boys were down there, and a lot of times they would throw the stones into the creek. So the one boy lifted up now these stones are boulders, I call them, and he saw hair. So he called the police, and myself and another detective went down there. Knowing that she was missing all that time, I said to the other guy, I said, it wouldn't surprise me if this is a young female that's Tina Knobb, because that's how we could identify her so quick, because we knew she was missing, and it was, her body was found in a condition that would be consistent with 15 months missing. So we started doing the investigation. of course, we did the whole scene, and she was buried not very deep. Actually, it looked like someone would have just moved most of the boulders, dug down a little bit, put her in there, and put the boulders on top of her. So when this kid threw the boulder off, that's when he saw the hair. And of course, he got scared, you know, and called for the police.
So may I ask you a question before you go on?
Yeah.
So in the position, like the way the body was buried in it, and I remember reading that the body was found like in an industrial size, like garbage bag.
On the what?
Yeah, like an industrial size, like trash bag. I don't know if that was true or not.
It was found?
Underneath the bridge and it was buried, but she was inside of a garbage bag.
No, that's not true.
That's not true, okay.
No, she was just...
Just there?
Just there.
Okay.
Yeah.
And from, in your honest opinion, from there to there, do you think that it was placed that she was killed there and put in place there, or...?
That's one of the unknowns. I have my suspicions of what happened. I always said the boyfriend was a key suspect in my mind, and because he was the last one to see her, claimed that he wasn't going to let her go, and then he says, I finally said, okay, go ahead and go. But then he didn't bother reporting her missing or anything. There's two children, one of them was fairly newborn. You'd think someone would wonder itself why the mother didn't come back to those two children. Never called or nothing. So, you know, you look at those circumstances. Now, where they lived was on the 300 block of West Market on the north side of the street. So her body was found under the Prince Street Bridge, the east bank on the south side. You know, you would have had to go down around to get under there. You can't really get there from Princess Street because of the bridge, the way it's designed. So you would have had to go around and come in to get under the bridge from the south side.
So the way it looks now with the like the railings and things like that were they there like in the 80s?
Oh yeah, pretty much nothing. I don't think anything changed on that bridge.
No, like down on the trail. So like if you go down on the trail now, there's like railings that, like you can't just go down to the
water. That probably changed.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think there was any railing. The rail trail wasn't even there at that time.
Okay.
You know, that came
later. The way
later.
It exists now, it doesn't look like
that. Yeah, no.
Okay.
So once we find her, of course, now we really start a homicide investigation. There's a couple bad things that happened. John, who was the boyfriend, moved out of that apartment. So now we don't have a crime scene, really. Several people moved in after that, so we didn't have anything there to go by. There was a lot of circumstances that we, in interviews and stuff, that, led us to think that he would be the prime suspect. But that's pretty much natural in any domestic homicide. Is always the boyfriend or wife or husband, or in some cases a wife. That's your number one side to look at. You know, and unless you can exhaust them totally, you still look and check out every other angle. But when you find nothing, you still have to come back to the parties that knew her most, or him if it's a male that was killed, and the circumstances, you know, around it. One of the things that we noticed when we found her, now by the way, this was a skeleton remains because it was consistent with 15 months being somewhere. We did some research we knew that the water level had raised many times in that 15 months. So we went back through some records through the water company and stuff, how much rain we had, and you know, because at times that body would have been, even though it was high up on the bank, it would have been underwater, you know, because we did some research into how much rain we had on certain days that would have raised the creek. And, you know, being in York, I knew when the creek was high. I just didn't record the dates at the time because it wasn't anything material. So anyhow, we did that. We at the time of the autopsy, or when we recovered the body, she had a jacket on which belonged to the boyfriend. Had a name on it. It was his jacket, and it didn't fit her properly. The other interesting thing was her shoes, which were sneakers, had no shoestrings in them. Now, we questioned when we interviewed the boyfriend. He said, well, I took them out because at one point he tied the door, had like a deadbolt plus a knob. He tied around the two of them with such tightness you couldn't unlock the door. He told us that's what he did. And I don't know if you can picture that or not.
So she couldn't get out. So
right, she couldn't get out. See, that's why she didn't have shoestrings in her shoes. The other thing about it was, a lot of times after you have a baby, women have that, I call it baby fat, until it goes away in their stomachs. So they said she used to have to lay down on the bed to get her blue jeans snapped and the zippers up. When we found her, that was open, which in my mind, it could indicate that he, the suspect, dressed her and couldn't get the pants shut. You know, because we wondered about that. And we never did know an exact cause of death, because there was no, you know, it was just skeletal remains, but there was no fractures of bones. We never did come up with an exact cause of death. I know she wasn't strangled, or else she would have, usually the hyoid bone would snap. That was not broken. So, you know, we didn't have, we looked for scars, I mean, not scars. If you cut someone, you hit a bone, it would be like if you hit a piece of wood, now it chips out a little bit. We looked at that, couldn't find it. Because not only did we have a pathologist do this, we had Dr. Levisky, who was the anthropologist out at York College, examined the bones for us too, to look for that very thing, to see if she would have been cut or chopped at or anything like that. Couldn't find anything. So we never did know cause of death. We have our suspicions how someone dies like that. You know, could have been trauma somewhere that didn't show up and wouldn't fracture a bone, but enough to kill you.
So I guess to double back on what you're thinking, you think it happened at the house, and he dressed her and took her down.
That's my beliefs.
Okay.
But nothing positive to back that up.
Right.
You know, if we had something to back that up, we would have made an arrest.
There was, I read, again, correct me if I'm wrong, that there was a tip that was called in, that when she had ran away from the house, she was at a party and took something and died at the party and then was placed down there. Did you ever hear that?
Never.
Okay.
I know we went to that house that the boyfriend said she was going to go to, which is only around the corner and up about a block. And we talked to them. They said, no, they talked to her on the phone earlier and said, well, I'm going to try and come up. But she never came up. She never got there. That's another thing that why, okay, if he didn't want her to go, he locked the doors in and everything else that. That's why she didn't go. Because she couldn't get out of the house. You know. Now the other interesting thing is we found out that, you know, in our minds we were trying to figure out if he did it, how to get her from that place to where she was found. Remember I said you had to cross Marcus Street, King Street, Princess Street, and then go across the bridge and come in from the other side, because it was on the east bank of the creek. So thinking about that, we had a person tell us about, they had purchased some type of furniture where you put it together and it comes in, a lot of times it comes in flat slabs and then you put it all together. So the boxes were so big, and actually this was Tina's mother told us about this. And she said, she asked him, well, what happened to the boxes that were here? He said, oh, I don't know. You know, Tina's mother's thinking and ours sort of then said, well, maybe she was put in that box and carried away that way. Because, you know, if you carry a person, that's too suspicious. Even if it's in the middle of the night, someone's going to see something usually. So we said, you know, if you have a box. Now, we didn't find the boxes, but they would have been big enough to put her in, according to the mother. You know, I didn't see the boxes, but Tina was not a big girl. You know, she was, she probably wasn't even 5 feet or maybe right around 5 feet. So she wasn't real big, you know, and thin girl, you know. So, you know, we have a lot of theories of what happened, but not enough to ever make an arrest. And since this, I know some other detectives have gone back, and they, every so often they'll do what they call cold case research again. They'll go back and revisit the whole thing. Go out and interview the people that we interviewed before to see if, and no one ever could develop anything on it. So, I mean, to me, the only person that knows is the person that did it, you know. And we did a lot of research on the boyfriend. Shortly after Tina disappeared, according to other people in the apartment house, he moved in with the girl downstairs, you know, which is there again, a little suspicious, you know. And then we interviewed every one of his girlfriends that we could trace. And he had about three after that, if they broke up with him, you know, we'd go back and interview him. You know, did he ever talk about Tina, you know, his first girlfriend? We couldn't get anything there. You know, we interviewed at least, I'm going to say three different girlfriends that this guy had after Tina. And we could never get anything to really materialize. We had him set up. He first said he was going to do a polygraph with us. So we went out to his house, picked him up, brought him in. Once he got in there, he said, no, I want a lawyer. Well, we knew we were done at that point. The lawyer was going to tell him, not only don't do that, don't ever say anything again. That's when we sort of lost contact with him. Although we did, we're following things up. You know, he talked to everyone. If he had a job somewhere, we'd find out where, we'd try and talk to the other employees. Did he ever say anything, you know? Because some people, if they, not knowing him, he might have said something that they didn't think anything about, and so we talked to him, but we got nowhere. With friends, ex-girlfriends, you know, especially when he, you know, we were thinking maybe he'd be stupid enough to say, like when he broke with him, you mess with me, you'll get the same thing Tina got or something like that. Well, that was never told to us. If it was ever said that, an ex-girlfriend didn't reveal it to us. You know, that's one reason we went back to all these friends, to see if he would make some comment, which you read about that every so often, where some guy 20 years later makes some statement, and you say, wow, you know, I don't think he ever went to jail. Maybe he did. I don't know if you did that research. I thought he was arrested for something, but maybe he never went to prison on it, you know, even York County. Because we were, you know, we were checking constantly, figuring if he ever gets locked up, you know, you're in the cell with other people, and next thing you know, you get to talking about things, and I mean, that's how a lot of cases are end up being solved.
So aside from him, anybody else that
could have done it?
That you had maybe looked into or stuff that people have told you or?
We looked into everyone that we knew had contact with her. And surprisingly, most of them who knew the two of them would say they feel that the boyfriend had something to do with it. You know, now there again, they feel that way. Nothing to prove anything. We had another person who I think we got some leads, if you want to call them leads, we got some information about someone else, you know, that smoked pot or something like that. We couldn't get anywhere with any of that. I mean, we spent a lot of time on that case, really. You know, especially since I knew her and the family personally. You know, I spent a lot of time, you know, in trying to run everything down. And if we got a new lead, we would go check it out. And some of them we would, like I said, we created ourselves. We'd say, okay, he was with this girl, but I understand he broke up. Let's find where she's at now and track her down, you know, which we usually were successful in doing that.
From anything that you picked up from me, so you never established like an actual cause of death?
Never what?
Never established like an actual cause of death.
Never.
Really only had one prime suspect.
In my mind. Now, who knows? You never know. Some things could, you know, we looked at every now and then you read where there's a serial killer happened to come through and he did something and dumped the body somewhere. We never come up with anything on that theory, you know.
Nothing they could trace back. His name escapes me at the moment, but he killed a bunch of women in Harrisburg in the late 80s and the early 90s. And they found, they captured him, he was like on top of a roof.
Joseph Miller. Where is he from, York?
Harrisburg. But it wasn't too far, and it was kind of, there was at least four different women that he buried throughout like the junkyards and things like that in Harrisburg throughout that time. So it was similar as far as you couldn't really prove other than maybe strangulation or anything, but like you said, you couldn't prove there was any strangulation or anything that happened. The time frame was kind of, because it was 84, and it happened 85, and then he was active up until like the early 90s.
I never heard that name. And not that if we would have heard it, we would have looked into it.
Yeah.
Some of the circumstances of hers are sort of very different. I mean, if you come back to, I said how she appeared like she had her boyfriend's coat on. Mm-hmm. Didn't have shoestrings in her shoes. He explained how they got out. You know, and I don't see someone else
taking the time to.
Yeah.
Aside from hers, like any, do you think any of the other murders or anything that happened in the city, like after that or anything else, may have been connected or maybe?
No.
Just for the reasons you gave.
Yeah.
In 87, did you work Judy Ketterman's murder?
No, that was outside of the city, right?
Wait, Judy Ketterman. That was on the Beaver Street Bridge.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I personally didn't work that one. I was aware of it. I think I was down at the scene, but I didn't get assigned to that case. So
there has been one of the men that was convicted of killing her, Quintero Smart.
Yeah.
I'm not familiar with him at all. And one of the rumors and things and stuff that was bounced around that he might have been possibly the one that killed her.
I think he was interviewed on that, not by me though. Mm-hmm. You know. Yeah, I remember that case, yeah, because he lived down in the projects, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You never had any run-ins with him or nothing that you can?
No.
No.
And see her, I mean, we thought if she did leave the house, as the boyfriend claimed, and she never got to the friend's house, which is only about a block away, something could have happened to her between those two. As she walked down to Newbury Street and up Newbury for a block, something could have happened to her. You know, we realized that is a possibility. I don't know that some stranger, there again, anything could happen, would have done everything to get her over by the bridge when there's too many other places. If something happened to her in the path that she took, I don't know. And, you know, it's just some of these unknowns.
Right. You could speculate all day.
Yeah. And you can see the worst thing was the fact that we never got a chance to go into what could be or could have been the crime scene, which was the house, the apartment, because we had no reason to, you know, really at that point in time, only once we found the body did we really, and now we say, well, you know, three people or two other people lived in that apartment after he moved out. It's really difficult to.
So I'd say we're, what, 36 years, right? 36 years from when it happened, right?
Now.
Right, from now till when it happened. So
yeah, you know, I don't remember the actual date.
Yeah. Well, I'm 35, so it was about a year before I was born, so that's
okay. Oh, okay, that's all right. Yeah.
So let's say, you know, through, you say, modern police work in there, let's say the place is still intact, like the way it is. You think anybody could go in there today and find, like, any sort of evidence or anything that could, you know, find blood or something, like, any sort of trace of anything, even though with all the people that come and go on throughout that time? You think it's possible?
I guess in today's science, it's possible. But I see right now they're renovating that whole building.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I see this scaffolding up and they're in there. Who knows what they did, you know, since then. Anything's possible. That's how I look at stuff today. I mean, some of the stuff that you can do today, you couldn't even do 36 years ago. See, I don't know that we had DNA, not that I can remember anyhow, when all this happened.
So to your knowledge, none of the evidence and stuff that's there still has ever been tested for, like, anything else, any hair or anything else, like, since then?
Well, not for DNA at the time, you know. I mean, I guess they still have the clothing that we recovered on her body, you know. I don't know for sure if the city police still have it. I know there was twice since I retired even that a team of investigators were gonna revisit that case. Now how they made out, because they came and talked to me just like you are, everything I could tell them about them and any names, you know. And they had the reports, I guess, to take a look at the names of the people we interviewed, you know. But
we nothing, no other conclusions other than what you already had.
No. It's a tough case, really. It's you know, when you have something, but it's, to me, it's always possible it can be solved. Always today, more than back then, you might say. Because it's just sometimes things just happen.